Oh, hello. I'd like to welcome everybody as you find your way into Fiber Art Now's interactive magazine. We named it Fanfare, appropriately. But I don't know. As an artist, I find that my ideas are always spinning faster than my time allows me to implement them. So today we are excited to be introducing our wonderful guests that have been part of Fiber Art Now since the very beginning. Our guests from Feltloom, Lynette Freitag, and Don Bowles, and Dick Collins. So first, I want to say a bit about Fiber Art Now. We are a magazine, a quarterly magazine, which that's where our heart is, but we've been really interested in creating some interactive opportunities because we know how our, on our Facebook page and our Twitter, we have just a community of, a global community of really interactive, creative minds. So we thought we'd start the opportunity to interview some of our artists, authors, and creative business people. So today, welcome Lynette. I'm gonna click on you here first of all. So bear with us. These are it's kind of a very organic conversation. It's not it's not edited and lots of cameras. It's just coming right now from live from Kentucky, where you have a live and interesting working farm. And Lynette, why don't you start by telling us a little bit about your beautiful working farm you were telling me about?
Okay, well, I'd always love to talk about the farm. I've been on the farm for 30 years, and the farm is a Kentucky landmark and part of the National Historic Register. It is 330 acres. It's a working farm where we tend to the operations on a daily basis and take care of all kinds of animals. And we have a cow-calf operation as well as a sheep operation with a working wool mill where we start from scratch and develop products through their whole life cycle of a product. So we very much love the fiber side of the farm, and most of our time is spent there. And the Feltloom came as a result of a need for our farm.
Wow, those are lovely images. It looks splendid. The alpaca were your first creatures?
Actually, we had llamas first. Llamas. In 1987. We got llamas, and then we got alpacas shortly after that. In 1987, there were hardly any alpacas in the country, and very few llamas, too. But we got llamas and then decided we needed to learn about alpacas, and then we got hooked on fiber, and everybody kept saying, well, alpaca's the best fiber in the world, and I kept thinking, well, I have to understand why. So I had to get all the animals because I had to experience it myself. So then we got rabbits and goats and all different breeds of sheep so we could understand fibers from our own hands.
Wow. Well, you let me get these pictures pointed up here. Yeah, look how splendid they are. So tell us a little bit about the mill.
We have a working mill that we designed it as the first that I know of small-scale felting mill in the country. We built it to be able to make felt, and we had it so that we had a carding machine with a very big drum design, so we had our own carding machine design for our mill. And we started that in 2003 to be able to use the wool that our farm produced. And today, it's since we opened the mill, we've constantly had a backlog of work to do. And we do a lot of work for ourselves, plus we do a lot of research done for the Feltloom, plus we do a lot of work with other fibers. So our mill is a combination of research and production mill with all different kinds of fibers.
Yeah, it was interesting. Before we turned the broadcast on, I was getting to hear about some of the different, I'm thinking just this fluffy, soft stuff that's coming, but I know, Don, you were showing me some pieces of recycled plastic bottles you're even working with.
Yeah, there's this is a piece here that I've got in front. I don't know if you can see it. And that's basically recycled bottle that's been melded and blown out into fiber form, and it's used extensively in industry right now. Okay. Yes, go ahead.
I was just thinking when people are reaching out to find out about the animals, they're trying to reach out and get the fiber, but also you have the machines, your design of how to use all that fiber. The felt loom, the desktop, I don't know, you want to talk a little bit about those?
Okay. Well, we started out with, when Lynette came to me and somebody had introduced the felting needles, and one thing led to another, and she said we had to get some felting needles, and so that she said that was going to change her life. I think that was in about 2004 or something like that.
Actually, I was a wet felter, and I had some hats that I had overfelted that had holes in them, and he said, well, did you ever hear about this needle that fixed holes in wool? And I said, oh, no, I never heard about that. And so I said, you better get some. So he got some, and he brought them home, and that night with our little felting needle, I had a little hunk of wool, and he had a little hunk of wool, and he made a kung fu head, and I made a little chicken. And I said, this needle is going to change our lives, because I knew how I needed it for my fibers. And it did. It truly did. It went from one needle to two needle tool to a 60 needle tool to lots of needles to the felt loom.
So it was working with the needles, we began to understand the issues in using needles together. We had a couple of prototypes done, and then we went from that to developing the felt loom as you see it today. The last machine we developed was Alexi, which people kind of requested for a tabletop unit. So we manufacture machines like this at 72 inches, and we go all the way to 36 inches here.
So what makes that needle felting method different? I mean, how does the felt loom make it different?
The felt loom is very interesting because it gives you the ability to use the same technology that industry has. Industry had been using needle felting since 1890, and a lot of things changed in our world because of that technology. But that technology was only in the hands of large volumes of products that could be made, and they had like a minimum 200 or 2,000 pound runs of fiber. For you to use one fleece from one sheep wouldn't work for the industrial things. So machineries take an evolution, and you'll see how in a lot of different segments of industry, and for men there was the router that was used industrially, and then it was used commercially, and then cottage industry used it for smaller projects too. A router could be used for the hobbyist on the weekend at home. The needle felting had not taken that evolution. It was only available to industry. There was not a commercial version that we could use on a small scale. There was not a cottage industry version or a home version. So when I wanted to buy that technology, there was none to buy. So we went and looked to buy it, and we couldn't find it. So I said to Don, well, I think we're just going to have to build it. So it changed things because we can now have the ability to connect fibers quicker than we could by hand. It's a lot more productive. And it's a lot more forgiving than doing things by hand, because you can very lightly connect them and look at them and see if they're correct before you commit to making them solid and hard. Like when I was a wet felter, you started and you laid your fibers out, and once you laid them out and you started to rub them, you were committed to those fibers. If they had a hole in them or if you didn't like your design, it was very hard to change it. With the felt loom, you can lay your fibers down and say, well, hey, yeah, I didn't see that before. And you can run it through and move it lightly and then pick the piece up and fix it. So you can patch your holes or you can change your design before you commit to felting it hard. So that it's really given you a lot more productivity.
Well, the other thing that we were able to do is to, as we began to work with that, we were able to begin to find that if you knew what your intake was, you knew what your output was going to be. So we got the capability to produce fabric, and that hadn't been possible for the average person to do before. So using a felt loom, you can use either natural wools or blends of fiber and produce any kind of fabric you want now.
Or even recycled bottles.
That's right.
And you can also transform other fabrics. You can take pieces of material and add a wool to them and transform it into something different. You know, it's sort of a different thought to be able to go and use recycled or old vintage fabrics and totally change them by adding bats to them and connecting them. You couldn't do this with other techniques.
Do you want to show the tapestry piece that you have back there? I thought that was so clever.
Yeah, this is a piece that we have that was a valance that we deconstructed. So this was the pattern that was on the top of the valance. And then we took it apart and then took a bat and ran it through the back of it, so it came through the top. So we changed this piece of cold polyester into a warm wool and polyester piece of fabric, and you can see it kept the design. So it was able to change it, but still make it nice and usable in a different form. So we transformed fabric.
So here's the liner to it, and that's how it was used on the back. So you get the capability to take almost any fabric, add fiber to it, and totally transform it.
I can see on our chat area, we've been posting, you can see all sorts of ideas on your Pinterest page and on the Twitter and Facebook page. There's a lot going on with the felt loom images and the felt loom community. Someone's posting, it looks like Elena is posting that felt loom made garments that will be part of the New Mexico Fashion Week in 2015 as part of the Whisperit Fashion Show. That's pretty exciting. I know we have some images of what some of the fashion, some of the artists have been doing. I see them on your posters back there.
This is the lady that's the Whisper Spirits from New Mexico, and that's her design that she had brought to our owners event last year.
We have an owners event every year that the people can come and talk about their work and share the things that they do. And we brought in some models this year, so we had a little runway style show of the products that people made on professional models. So we had Sandy, a wonderful coat and hat on a model, and we took this picture at our owners event. So it came out great to share.
Yeah, I think we have some close-ups we'll be posting here shortly. So how do you add a design onto that felted fabric?
It's what you do is you would start with the base, and then you could take rovings or just pull it and add a design to it, or you could, you know, take other you could die cut pieces of a pre-felt and lay it onto it and then just run it together. Here's an example here. See, this is a scarf that we started with. And then we had, you can see that's the same basic scarf because the design is the same from one to the other. It was just a different color. And then we put a bat, very lightweight bat, on the scarf. And then we just added little flecks of color.
Beautiful.
So we transformed it from a plain scarf into something that was much warmer with a different design. And this was just little pieces of roving that were added and then felted together.
I know you were mentioning, wait, I'm trying to get those pictures. There we go. There's one of your pieces, your works, Lynette, and your little creature there. That's a great shot.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, that was fun to do. That's from the medium grade wool. People always say you have to use fine grade wools, but for survival 100 years ago, people lived in that medium grade wool. So I figured I would love to try to design things with it again, and I did that with that jacket. And the jacket is sold, it's gone, and I miss it, but we sure are making it. And Don made the buttons, so we worked together. So so it's sort of a farm project.
So other types of things that you have, that the your artists all over the world, you have artists from Germany to... you said you were listing all the New Zealand and
we have in 11 countries right now. We have artists in New Zealand, South Africa, and Australia, in Italy, Norway, Taiwan, Canada, United Kingdom. We just have them in lots of places.
San Marino,
yeah.
Italy.
Yeah, Dick, remember some of the places he shipped to, so yeah.
So you have three types of machines.
Yes.
Maybe you can show those, I don't know, it's going to be kind of tricky, but show us in your felt studio there.
Okay, so can you see, this is our Pro line.
This machine is what we call our Pro line. It comes in a 36-inch model, 48-inch model, a 66-inch model, and this is a 72-inch model we have here. So this is by far the biggest seller of the machines we have out there. Okay? And the difference in width gives you the capability of how wide the fabric is you can produce with it.
Wow.
The little
somebody, hold on a minute, hold on. You have a hello coming in from Australia from a friend that's named Judy, saying happy felt loom, she's a happy felt loom owner.
Yes, Judy Roberts. Hello, Judy. It's so wonderful to have you with us today.
All right, now there's the desktop over there.
Right. That unit is a unit that we do. We had a request for something that people didn't have a space for it. In fact, we have a designer in New York that she's on Madison Avenue, does floor covering, wall covering, and she does all her samples herself and then sends them out to get them made into big yardage. But she wanted something to fit on top of a desk. And we worked with her, and we'd had this unit in development. We then worked with her and brought it up to the speed what you see it is today, and she now uses that producing the samples or the prototypes that she then has to make and other things. So we have a number of these out in the U.S., Canada. We got one of these.
San Marino.
San Marino, and is a little principality in Italy. So
A very supportive community of people who own felt machines and the dealerships themselves. Maybe you could talk a little bit about that. Somebody's asking a question here about how easy are they to use.
Well, the felt loom is very easy to use. The felt loom, you turn it on and the rollers roll and the needles go up and down. It's very simple to run. the issue is always the designs and the what fibers you use, how thick, how thin, you know, what those are the always the things that take a lot more thought than actually using the felt loom. So we designed it to be simple. I was when I was working with the engineers on the initial prototypes, I told them, I said, this is to be like my bread machine. I want to put the ingredient in, push the button, and out comes bread. I want this felt loom to produce fabric the same way. And it's just about that easy. So if any of you have made bread, you know that it's the recipe that makes the bread taste good or bad. So the fibers coming out of the felt loom are what makes it. And the artist is the one who decides what to put in. So does that make sense?
I think make sure when if you check out their website, there's videos that show how they're used and a lot of information about this wonderful machine. As I said before, my head always has more ideas than I can ever keep up with. So I can see how this machine would help with people with an abundance of ideas on ways to use all these beautiful fabrics, including the recycled materials, the bottles, or the drapes. So, you know, I think that's just fascinating. Let's see. I wanted to also make sure we talked about some of the things I've heard that they've artists are making wine holders and carpets and, of course, custom upholstery fabrics. Anything you want to share that you've heard somebody using?
We've got several customers that are doing insoles with alpaca. They produce an insole that's becomes very warm and it's used a lot in the wintertime. So we've got alpaca people that are doing that. We've got a client in Vermont that is a milliner, and she is currently at the winter fair at Grand Central Station with a hat that she's made from the felt loom.
Oh, I see.
Yeah, she's wonderful. Swan and Stone Millinery in Vermont, and they did a Kickstarter to get funded to go to New York to be able to have a booth there at Grand Central Station. So this is a new venture for them, and it's the first we've seen the felt loom in this position. So we wish them the best of luck.
And what about the colleges and art schools? Are you finding that they're...
We now have it in four universities. We have a textile department, a fine art department so far. It seems like there's a lot of universities that really want them, but they having trouble funding with them, you know, getting funding. So I think universities will have more in time.
And if someone wanted to come to any of your events, I know you guys were up in Providence this summer. That's where I met you. But I know you have a lot of events both in Kentucky, where you're located. And other locations, do you have any ones that you want to highlight?
Well, we do have events at the farm. We're having a vest making class February 4th or 5th, I think, that we've got people signed up for that. And then we have at the end of February, the mill owners from the boutique mills or mini mills across the country, they get together, and they are coming to our farm and end of February, and then of course every fall we have our Felt Loom Owners event, and we haven't put a date on that yet, but that will be coming. And we go to shows and see people there, and so we still haven't put our whole agenda together for 2015, so we've got to get on the ball and do that. So if anybody has anything that's really think we ought to be there, let us know.
Okay, yeah, and I know that...
We'll be at the Pittsburgh Knit and Crochet Festival end of March. We've signed up for that. So.
Do you ever host people at your farm in Kentucky to see those felt looms?
Yes, we do. We have people come to see the felt loom. We make appointments and schedule time for them to have hands-on experience and use it with, they can bring their fibers if they want, or use our fibers, whatever they choose, they can come. And if it's a smaller group, we have a guest house on the farm, and they can stay right at the farm, and they don't have to go to a hotel. So.
Someone's asking, Teresa's asking, can you control the thickness of the fiber?
Can we control the thickness of the fiber going in?
Mm-hmm.
If the fibers, the rollers roll, they don't pinch. So if you have a larger pile of fibers and you want to compress them down to feed into the rollers, when you get them started, it takes the first time you run them, you have to stay on top of it to keep pushing them down to get it in. So I don't know if that's the question she wants to ask, if she wants to ask it again, if I didn't answer it.
Okay, Teresa, if that was an appropriate answer. You know, on the Feltloom website, they have videos that you can see them in action. I think with our webinar, if we tried to put one in action, it would be the sound quality would be probably kind of hard, and so we decided not to really have one in action. But there are great videos that Lynette and her team have put on the website, so you can see them. So anything that you're really proud of that you've seen done, or you've done yourself with your machine, anything you want to highlight and let us know?
Well, the thing that I am so proud of is the Feltloom community. Because the people that are in the community are all people that really have passion about fiber art, and they truly reach out and help each other. And that speaks far beyond anything that a single person can do themselves. And so I am just so proud of all of them and the group that we've created, and the people that work with us. I'm proud of what Marcia's done through helping us and through the people that work with us, Dick, and how he's so concerned with his quality control that goes out there. And it just takes a team of people to make technology go in the world. And basically, the Feltloom is new technology. So it's new to use it by hand.
Yeah, and the quality is so consistent. It's a beautiful quality that you see. I don't know if you have any pieces you want to hold up over there that you can show. That green piece that's, oh, there we go.
This one? Okay.
Yeah, bring it up close.
This was a fun piece because it was a piece that was done again with another valance, and we took it apart and put a bat to it. So we've made it something that was, after the movies, Gone with the Wind, we took the old curtain and made it into something that's very beautiful. So this piece here. But that's, you can see the brocade pattern stayed on it. But I've got some, I'll hold up a piece from the models where I'll get it over here. So.
I have a couple that we've got it for pictures I can post right now.
And so you can see the quality, the consistency. Now we make this, we make the bats thin and don't strip them so we can get consistent quality. So that's part of the work that we do. So this piece here is all the fabric. This is 100% sheep wool. This is not on another fabric. We can, with the Feltloom, you can use just fibers like this piece is. You can use fibers and you can put them on another fabric like we did with this, or this particular piece back here is done on burlap. They're just fibers, alpaca, needled through burlap. So we didn't have a bat for that. That's just the fibers on burlap. So you can go fiber to fiber, fiber to fabric, or you can also layer the fibers and the fabrics into a sandwich type thing with multiple layers together.
Yeah, they look so different than, oh, look, there's a lovely pocketbook.
Yeah, this one we took a yarn that we had, a novelty type yarn, and then we laid it on some bats and just needled the yarn into the fibers. So rather than weave it, it was just needle felted in. So it's a lot faster than weaving. It's hard to weave in the round. So.
Right. We've got some pictures here. Who's the artist that did this beautiful piece?
Laverne Zabilski did that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's really. How did she get that pattern of that on that coat?
The pattern came. Let me see. I'm having a hard time seeing it close up. But she is a great dye artist as well as a felt loomer. So she takes a lot of the existing fibers and needles them together. She starts with white bats and white silk, and she does the shibori dye method to patterns on them. So people combine different techniques. Yeah.
This piece here that you see was
same artist, Laverne.
Same artist.
I see. Right. Although people are saying some very one person who bought a felt loom, let's see, Carrie. Is that Carrie or Carl?
Carl.
Okay. She bought a felt loom 2 months ago and was very pleased with it. And also the support that she gets from your team, Don and Lynette. She's an alpaca farmer and believes this machine will help the whole alpaca fiber market tremendously. It is easy to use, and the only limit of what can be made is your own imagination. So she says she recommends the Lexi to anyone. I would love.
Let me correct you on it. It's Carl. It's a he.
Oh, it's a he. Carl. Excuse me. I can't see the words there. But well, good. That's a really wonderful testimonial, Carl. And I hope we can see some of the work you're doing. You know, if you want to make sure you email us over at Fiber Art Now, or you can post it over on the Fiber Art Now Facebook page. We welcome the opportunity to see what other artisans and craft people are doing with these machines. It's pretty exciting. And June, hold on, Victoria, I'm gonna put on some of those. Yeah, some of those nice images you had. Let's see here. So June says she has a craft group. Oh yeah, what artist is that? I'm sorry, I'm jumping back and forth. But
this one on the screen right now is Debbie Brumlich from South Africa.
Wow. Nice. It looks so soft.
Yeah, and that's Sandy Liggett from New Mexico.
Nice. Well, June is messaging here saying she has a craft group that meets once a week, and they have converted from wet felting rugs to felt loom rugs made of llama. And now they have gone to many other projects using the loom. Too many ideas, not enough time. Yeah, that's probably really the biggest problem with the felt loom, right? Well, good. Well, that was good to hear from some of the users out in the community, from Australia to, I'm not sure where Carl is located, but it sounds like
He's in where?
Missouri.
Missouri. Okay. So, and it was lovely to see some pictures of Victoria's got another good one here. Oh boy, look at Laverne Zablinski's work. That's just splendid. And she's one of, wow, look at that. That's really beautiful. I'm glad we found, she's a Kentucky artisan there. Thank you for finding that image. Anyway, we were lucky to hear from so many people, and it was nice to hear more about the intricacies and all the animals you have at your historic location there in Kentucky. I hope someday my car gets up there. Wait, I'm going to see. I see more good pictures, and I hate not to post them. Look at that. Now, who's is that?
That's Laverne's.
That's one.
Wow, look at that. Boy. Do you have any specials right now for maybe for the holidays?
Well, it's what we said for the month of December, that if they people purchased a Foutloom, that we would have free shipping on it. So, and if they to come to Kentucky in December and have a class training with the Foutloom they buy, we will give them a free day of training.
Wow. Okay, I'll be there tomorrow.
Okay, great.
That's really nice. Look at those pieces. Boy, these are some splendid images right here. Well, okay, I wanted to thank you very much for taking the time, the three of you, to come and share with us your felt studio there and tell us about your business. We hope everybody goes to their website or on their Pinterest page and their Facebook page. And, of course, we want you to share with Fiber Art Now any things that you're working on. We're very interested in seeing what's happening in our textile community. And I guess that's all. Thank you very much, everybody, for attending. Bye-bye.
Thank you.